take things in a slightly different direction from what you might call mainstream philosophy, but thinking perhaps about philosophy in the way the ancient Greeks did, which was as a way of life and had a vertical as well as a horizontal dimension, for want of a better expression. So I'm Mark Vernon, and Jules Evans is around as well. I'll introduce Rupert Sheldrake, our speaker for this evening, very shortly, but perhaps first of all just to say something about St George's Bloomsbury. I can welcome you on behalf of the vicar. I'm not the vicar, I used to be a vicar actually, but I'm not anymore. And we thought this space would be wonderful for many reasons, partly because it's central and so on, but also because it's a Hawksmoor church, and one of the things that Hawksmoor does in a spectacular way is kind of crash different traditions together. You know, it's a bit classical, a bit Christian, a bit all sorts of things. And it's a perfect cube, this central space, by the way, for those of you who have a Pythagorean streak. So in some ways, that bringing together of different traditions is partly what we were hoping to achieve with these London Philosophy Club Wisdom Talks. And Rupert Sheldrake, sitting here, is a very, very good person to do that too. If you don't know already, Rupert began life as a plant biologist, working in Cambridge and then for the government in India. Since then, he has worked not only on science, but also in parapsychology. So not only knows a lot about science, but also about the scientific method and how you go about trying to test these things, as anyone who's serious about parapsychology very quickly gets involved with. But there's a third side to Rupert that I myself have seen a lot of, which is the spiritual side in the sense of being wise about spiritual traditions too. Like myself, Rupert is an Anglican, but knows an awful lot about different religious traditions, and in this kind of lived sense too, not just kind of theology, what they believe, but what it might be to have a spiritual sensibility, and then particularly how that links up to science, and that great task of integration which causes controversy as well as great interest, I think, in the modern day. So Rupert's going to talk to us for about 20 minutes or so about spirituality, spiritual experience and science. He's then going to pose a kind of discussion question for us to break into groups of two or three to talk amongst ourselves for 10, 15 minutes. Then he'll come back and say some more, and then we'll have plenty of time for question and answers at the end as well. So I hope there's ample time to not only hear him, digest some thoughts yourself, but also to come back to him at the end as well. So let me introduce Rupert Sheldrake.
Thank you, Mark. Can everyone hear me all right? Okay. All right. Well, I'm very pleased to be here, and this is a subject which I think is a particularly important one at the moment. When I was an undergraduate in the 1960s, I was a scientist, and I'd absorbed the culture of science in Britain at that time, which was almost entirely atheistic. It was taken for granted that if you were a scientist, you were an atheist, as indeed I was. And it was taken for granted that religion and spirituality were simply relics of the past that would fade away. It was taken for granted that religion would fade away, and also that spirituality was a kind of illusion, possibly experienced most by the mentally ill. So there was a very negative attitude to the subjects we're talking about this evening. But things have changed enormously. First of all, religion hasn't faded away as widely predicted. And secondly, there's a kind of backlash against the survival of religion. We had the new atheism, with particularly that flood of books around 2006, Richard Dawkins, The God Delusion, Sam Harris, The End of Faith, Daniel Dennett, Breaking the Spell, and Christopher Hitchens, God is Not Great, Why Religion Poisons Everything. A torrent of atheist polemics. And One of the things that was a key theme there was that the persistence of religion and why it had to be either counteracted or at least explained away. Daniel Dennett tried to explain religion, and this is a common theme in atheist circles. It can't be just dismissed as something that's based on ignorance, stupidity, and feeble-mindedness. Its persistence has to be explained in terms of genes. So Daniel Dennett, in his book Breaking the Spell, comes up with a number of hypotheses about why religion might be hardwired into our genes. And one of them is that in the past, people who were particularly credulous would have been selected for by natural selection. So there must be a credulity gene. And the reason that natural selection would have favored the credulity gene is people who were credulous, when they went to witch doctors or shamans, would have believed the mumbo jumbo more than other people, had a bigger placebo effect, and survived more. So this gene would have spread in the population. Well, an ingenious theory, but it doesn't convince many people, and of course there's no evidence whatever for credulity genes. We've had an interesting change of mood in the last year or two, because aggressive atheism is sort of giving way to something more interesting. One of Britain's leading atheist philosophers, Alain de Botton, wrote a book a couple of years ago called Religion for Atheists, in which he argues that religion and spirituality provide essential features of being human, and that atheists are really missing out by having cut themselves off from those. And he then tries to reinvent religion for atheists. The Sunday assembly, secular churches on Sundays, Sunday sermons, where you just have the sermon without the singing and the rest of it. An attempt to create ways in which atheists can have some of the benefits of religion. Interestingly, one of the other new atheists, Sam Harris, has a book that's just come out, or is just coming out, called Waking Up, which is called Spirituality Without Religion. Sam Harris has gone over to spirituality now. He's arguing for spirituality, but still against religion. And he comes up with a kind of Buddhism light as his answer. So this is a very, very interesting change of mood, and the strident polemics of Richard Dawkins are now the subject of widespread ridicule here in Britain. So I think we're on a cusp of something very different and interesting. What I want to do this evening is talk about some aspects of how scientific studies can actually shed some light on spiritual practices. I'm not talking about religious beliefs or doctrines. I'm talking about the actual experience and practice of spirituality, which is much more widespread in Britain, at least, than the practice of religion. There are lots of people who call themselves spiritual but not religious. And there are lots of people who call themselves spiritual and religious. But the practice is what I'm focusing on. And the practice itself has been studied quite extensively, more in the United States than Britain. There have now been a very large number of studies of the effect of religious practice on people's lives, particularly in relation to health. And many studies in the United States have shown that people who have regular religious practice, like going to church, a mosque, or synagogue on a regular basis, have actually quite different profiles in relation to health. On the whole, they live longer. White males, on average, live about 5 years longer if they're religious. Black males in America are about 15 years longer. You know, somebody remarked, if someone had discovered a pill that had that kind of effect, it would be all the rage. There'd be headline news in the newspapers about it. There have been specific studies on meditation and prayer, and most of them have shown very beneficial effects. For example, a study that was done in North Carolina by Harold Koenig, he did a prospective study of people aged over 65, 1,790 people, and they were divided into two groups. One were a group of people who prayed regularly, and the other were people who didn't, but otherwise they were matched for age, socioeconomic class, general conditions of life, etc. And the 5 years later, these people were examined to see what had happened. Those who prayed regularly, 66% more had survived that period than the others, and this is a massive effect. And he then looked at confounding variables like life stresses in people's lives, nutritional variations, and so forth. And if you took out the confounding variables, it went down to 55%, but it was still a massive effect. Now, why should that be so? We don't know yet, but these studies show huge effects. Here in Britain, there have been many scientific studies on the effect of mindfulness meditation, so much so that it's now recommended by the National Institute of Clinical Excellence, NICE, for the NHS. And you can now get mindfulness meditation on prescription in some parts of Britain. This is particularly for people who are suffering from mild depression. It's been found to be more effective and cheaper, that's the important part for the NHS, than antidepressant pills. And depression costs the National Health Service more than £7 billion a year. So something that's completely non-invasive, free basically, that's proven to work, is now being recommended scientifically, on scientific grounds. So we're dealing here with phenomena that are definitely spiritual practices, but which have measurable, scientifically measurable effects. Another way in which science has looked at meditation is through looking at the brains of people who are meditating. As you probably know, there have been quite a lot of studies now in which people have done fMRI scans of people meditating. There's some particularly good ones on Tibetan monks. And these scans show that particular regions of the brain light up or become more active when people are meditating, particularly in the limbic system, which is concerned with emotions, and in the frontal lobes of the brain. Some atheists conclude from this that meditation is nothing but an effect on the brain, because they usually think the mind is nothing but the brain. But of course, the fact that changes happen in the brain doesn't prove it's nothing but the brain. If someone did an fMRI scan on you now, or at least an EEG scan, your brain would show particular patterns of activity associated with the fact you're looking at this church and looking at me. And say you're looking at me and there'd be particular changes in your brain which could be measured by science. That doesn't prove that I'm nothing but an activity in your brain. If people have spiritual experiences and there are changes in the brain, it doesn't prove they're nothing but changes in the brain. It shows that certain regions of the brain are associated with those experiences, maybe an interface with the spiritual realm in the nervous tissue, but it doesn't prove it's nothing but that. In the 1970s and 80s, there were some very widespread studies carried out in Britain by Sir Alistair Hardy and his unit in Oxford, the Religious Experience Research Unit. Sir Alistair Hardy was a zoologist, professor of zoology at Oxford, and he thought that mystical experience was very interesting, and he came across many people who said they'd had mystical experiences. And he carried out large-scale surveys in Britain of mystical experience. He appealed for information through newspapers and through BBC radio. And they collected thousands of reports from people about their mystical experiences. And he thought that this should be approached in a scientific spirit. And the first thing in any science is to build up the natural history. So they worked out the natural history of these mystical experiences. And they published quite a few books with this classification. Some of them are experiences people have in nature, a sense of tremendous presence when they're in a beautiful place, you know, in the forest or on a mountaintop or seeing a sunset. Many people have those. Some happened when people were in love. Some happened when they were in a crisis through near-death experiences or out-of-the-body experiences. Some happened in religious services. Some just happened for no apparent reason. There were many ways in which people had these mystical experiences, which were defined in terms of a sense of a presence or a sense of being in the presence of a consciousness or mind greater than one's own. He used a deliberately vague definition. And what he found in this pioneering work was that these experiences were far more common than anyone had assumed. He discovered, in fact, that there was a huge taboo about talking about them in modern Britain. Just as in Victorian England there was a taboo about talking about sex, there's now no taboo at all, or at least hardly any taboo. People talk about it all the time, especially on Channel 4. And but there's a taboo about talking about mystical experience, because people were afraid they'd be thought weird, odd, or even mad if they mentioned it. And many of the people who wrote to Sir Alistair Hardy and his team said that this is something they'd never told anyone about, not even their husband or wife or their children or their parents, because it was such a private thing. They were afraid they'd be ridiculed or scorned. That, again, is a very important thing, that mystical experiences are not rare. They're quite common, and I think probably most people here this evening would have had one or more experience in which they felt themselves part of a greater consciousness or presence, going to some region that goes beyond their normal discursive mind. Not necessarily through prayer or meditation, but very often spontaneously. Now, one of the things that occurs in all cultures around the world is a belief that some places are particularly sacred. The Australian Aborigines have their song lines that go, they take them to these great sacred places, the most iconic of which is Ayers Rock in the centre of Australia. And there are many kinds of sacred places. Some of them are caves, and we know that some of the first sacred places that we know of in Europe were caves. Those cave paintings in France and Spain, where there are those marvellous images on the walls of caves, deep inside dark caves, turn out to be in places where the acoustics are particularly resonant. And it's almost certain that people would have been carrying out rituals there, chanting or drumming, and they may also have been taking mind-altering substances. The Eleusinian mysteries in Greece were in caves and certainly involved psychedelics. No one's quite sure what. There's one kind of sacred place that are caves. Another kind of sacred place are places where important things have happened, where people have had visionary experiences like Lourdes in France, or where great men or women have died or have been born. There are lots of places where people go to the birthplace or the death place, or places where they're buried. Many in the Middle Ages, many of the places of pilgrimage in England were places where there were relics of saints, the most famous of all being the relics of St. Thomas Becket in Canterbury. But there's another category of sacred places which are traditionally believed to be the meeting place between heaven and earth, to form a bridge between the realm above and the realm below, or the terrestrial realm. And these are also very ancient. The oldest forms are probably megaliths, standing stones, which stand up into the sky and, as it were, connect heaven and earth. An example of one occurs in the Old Testament, where Jacob lies down to sleep and has this vision of angels ascending and descending between heaven and earth. And then it says, surely this place is a holy place. And it says in the Bible, he raised up a stone to commemorate this place. Well, did Jacob raise up a standing stone because he'd had a vision in that place, or did he lie down asleep beside an already existing standing stone that was a connection between heaven and earth? We don't know. But standing stones are one form. Obelisks are a much more refined form of standing stone in Egypt, which are monolithic, a single stone, often with a little tip, with metal on the tip, gold. We have one here on the embankment, of course. That's an Egyptian obelisk that was brought here to Britain by the embankment gardeners. You would have seen it on this side of the Thames. And that is a genuine Egyptian monolith. And the story, if you read the plaque, tells you what a terrible job they had getting it here. Looting Egypt and taking it to Britain was not a simple thing. It was the ships bringing it here were assailed by storms, they sank. It was really hard to get it here. But anyway, we have one here in London. Then, of course, towers are a very ancient feature of sacred places, and spires. Most churches in England have towers and spires. And many Muslim sacred places have minarets. So in Hindu temples, they have big metal poles that come up by the Nandi in the sacred bull, the statue of the sacred bull. They often have these towers. These could be seen as symbolic, connecting heaven and earth, but I think they're actually more than that. If you think what happens when you have a tall, upright thing in an otherwise fairly flat landscape, it becomes the primary focus through which lightning strikes the earth. These are lightning attractors. The higher they are, the more they attract the lightning, and the more they sort of channel in lightning. If there's a whole area over which lightning could strike at random, if there's a tall thing in the middle, it's going to be channeled in through there. So I think that they're best seen as lightning attractors that actually attract the lightning and bring it down to earth in that place. So they're literally places that connect heaven and earth. And until recently, people thought that lightning was a purely local phenomenon, somehow caused by friction between clouds and the earth. No one could ever quite remember the details. It turns out that it's actually much more interesting. It's now known that there are enormous electric discharges going right down from the ionosphere to the clouds. They're called sprites. And they connect the electric layers around the earth, which in turn are related to the solar wind and the currents of electricity and of charged particles coming from the sun that bathe the whole earth and move around it in the ionosphere. There's a protective envelope called the magnetopores. When the sun becomes exceptionally active, there are more of these. That's why the northern lights and the southern lights become more active during periods of extreme solar activity, but so do lightning strikes. Interestingly, people seem to have disregarded this side of sacred buildings. And I was talking to some people at a church where the church warden was an electrical engineer. And I said to him, "Do you know how often lightning strikes your church?" And he said, no idea. I said, "But wouldn't it be easy to find out? All churches have lightning conductors. You have a huge electric current going down them. It wouldn't be rocket science to have a kind of induction thing near to it where you could actually record when the lightning strikes. If I were an entrepreneur and many years younger, I think I'd invent one and patent it and sell it online, because most people who have tall buildings, even if they're not sacred places, would probably be quite interested to know how often lightning strikes and when it strikes. We've so turned the heavens into something merely symbolic that we forget these are about real forces and real connections. In all cultures too, there's a way in which people connect to sacred places through pilgrimage. And pilgrimages are sacred journeys. But again, if you look at it from a broader scientific perspective, you see that we're dealing here with something that's much older than humanity. Migration is found among insects and mammals and birds. Many, many species are migratory. And species migrate in order to find more warmth or more nourishment. Like swallows come here in the summer from Africa because it's warm here in the summer and they can breed here and there's plenty of food. And they go back in the autumn to southern Africa where it's warm and they can overwinter somewhere much more comfortable than the British Isles. So this migration is very deep in animal nature, and our ancestors who were hunter-gatherers migrated with their animals and when they were with the seasons. And then herders, like itinerant herders of sheep and goats still do in India and elsewhere, migrate with their flocks. The Lapp people still migrate with the reindeer herds. And I think that this migratory urge is very deep in human nature. And it comes out in almost all cultures in pilgrimage, which are journeys to sacred places. The pilgrimage is not just a journey, it's a journey with a particular end or goal. And the pilgrimage is a sacred journey. The whole pilgrimage itself is part of that, not just the place you get to. And we had many pilgrimages here in England in the Middle Ages. The Protestant Reformation changed the consciousness, because in the Protestant Reformation there was an attempt to suppress what they saw as pagan pre-Christian religious practices. Those Protestant reformers were scholars, and they read the Bible. And there's nothing about the sacred places of England, like Canterbury or Walsingham, in the Bible. There's only things about the sacred places of the Holy Land. So they identified all these places of pilgrimage as pagan hangovers that had been superficially Christianized. Well, they were right in many cases, but that didn't alter the fact these were very, very important places to go to. And at the Reformation here in England, pilgrimage was suppressed. The troops of the king removed the shrine, they raided the shrine of Our Lady of Walsingham, the Black Madonna, the most important Mary shrine in England, and her image was burned in a public bonfire. The troops guarded the roads to Canterbury to prevent pilgrims entering Canterbury on a pilgrimage. Pilgrimage was forcibly suppressed, as it was in other Protestant countries. Of course, it continued in Catholic countries and is still flourishing today in the pilgrimage to Santiago of Compostela, and also the shrine of St. James of Santiago de Compostela. Pilgrimages, of course, still flourish in Ireland. The pilgrimage to the ancient sacred mountain, Croagh-Patrick, is still a huge centre of pilgrimage in Ireland. It was never stopped in these Catholic countries. In India, there are pilgrimages which involve millions of people. I saw them myself when I was living in South India. People walk hundreds of miles on pilgrimages to temples. So, in England, where pilgrimage was suppressed, it didn't make this urge to travel go away, it simply secularized it. So it was the English who invented tourism, which within a few generations of the suppression of pilgrimage had become something aristocrats did, the grand tour. And what tourists did was go to the ancient sacred places, you know, the temples, the churches, the cathedrals, the ancient sacred sites. Now tourism is a vast global phenomenon, and still most tourists go to ancient sacred places. The trouble is that as tourists, which is secular, they have to pretend that they're not going there to say a prayer or to ask for some blessing. They have to pretend they're going there because they have a deep interest in art history. And as soon as they arrive, tourist guides spring up and tell them all sorts of facts. And this building was built in 1326, contains 85 million tons of stone, etc., etc. Facts that go in one ear and come out the other. Because they're not really interested in that at all. They've gone because it's a sacred place, but being disempowered by being secular, they can't actually kneel down and say a prayer or light a candle. Interestingly, all our cathedrals in England now, and many of our churches in the Church of England, have candles. When I was a child, none of them did. It was considered too Catholic. But it's now absolutely everywhere. And so you can actually light a candle, and many people do. In my hometown, Newark-on-Trent, there's now, for the last 15 years, there's been candles, and dozens of people a week come in and pray in the church and light candles. People who don't go to services, but just who find it to go into a sacred place to say a prayer and light a candle. It's kind of mini pilgrimage. And I find that this is a deeply attractive idea. I went on pilgrimages in India, and when I came back to England, I rediscovered this wonderful Christian tradition of pilgrimage. A couple of months ago, I have a 14-year-old godson, and I thought, what shall I do for his birthday? And I thought, I'm not going to give him anything. I don't give stuff to children anymore, because they've all got far too much stuff, like the rest of us. I give experiences, you know, football matches to my football-mad great-nephew, and horse riding for my great-niece, who's keen on horses. This young man, I suggested a pilgrimage to Canterbury, and I wasn't sure if he'd go for this or not, but I actually loved the idea, and we took the train to Chawton, which is about 5 or 6 miles from Canterbury. It's a small rural stop, and we walked the last part of the North Downs Way, the pilgrim path, through woods and orchards and meadows, past Bigbury Fort, which is where the first battle between Julius Caesar and the British occurred. and then past the Black Prince as well, which is on the way to Canterbury, which we couldn't find. An old woman showed it to us. We had to part the foliage and go down mossy steps to this clear water. It was amazing. It's just 2 miles from Canterbury. It's really hard to find and obviously very rarely visited. Then we went to the cathedral. And as in India, I think to walk around a place you're going to visit is the best thing. Circumambulate it in the direction of the sun, clockwise. Makes it the center, and then you go in. So we did that. And we had a wonderful time. We went to Koh Samui. We lit candles. And it was a most wonderful experience for both of us. So it's possible here in England today to go on pilgrimage, as it always has been. So these were just a few reflections on things that are traditional spiritual experiences: prayer, meditation, spontaneous mystical experiences, regular religious practice, in that's a minority pursuit in Britain today, but these other things are much more common. And since it's the practice of the philosophy club to have a period where you have discussions, at this stage, we thought what would be the most relevant is if in groups of two or three, you share experiences, an experience or more than one, but start with just one, in which you felt you were connected to something greater than yourself, a mystical experience or a pilgrimage or a visit to a sacred place. It's possible that there are some people here who've not had any of those experiences, but I think it's very unlikely. And if even some very atheistic scientists like Richard Dawkins talk about the sense of awe they feel in nature, so that counts as well, even though it's not branded spiritual by him. So I think this would be a good chance. My emphasis this evening, what I hope the discussion would be about, is about experience rather than ideas. We have to start from experience. We can then have ideas about the experience, but I think it's really helpful to start with the experience and also to share it with someone else, because it may be something you haven't talked about before. There is a taboo about these things, but nobody's going to think you're mad. Well, I don't know what kind of experience you tell them, perhaps some of them will. But on the whole, it's lots of people have experiences, and it's perfectly normal part of being human to have them. So we'll take just over 10 minutes for that, and we'll stop now. Scientifically now, for 20 years or more, they first came to public attention, I think, through the book by Dr. Raymond Moody, who collected these experiences from a lot of people who'd nearly died and found that they had many features in common. And he wrote a book, Life After Life, which summarized the general natural history of these near-death experiences. Those were mostly based on just people's personal testimony. And at first some people said, oh, they're just making it up. But it was perfectly clear that people had very powerful experiences that had, in many cases, changed their lives. And then there was the question of how do you interpret them? Because most people who've had these experiences feel that they really have moved out of their body, they've gone to another realm, they've had an experience of profound connection in a sense of love and light, and then they've come back into their body. So it's as if they died and been reborn. That's how it seems to them. But there are, of course, many people who are materialistically minded who want to interpret them in a different way. Susan Blackmore is one such. And she's interesting in that she's a skeptic who has herself had a near-death experience. So she reinterpreted her own near-death experience to say, well, it must just have been anoxia in the brain. You know, the brain, when you're nearly dying, the circulation's not working properly. It's a disturbance of the brain that creates a kind of hallucinatory experience. Well, we know a bit more about them now than we did then, when she put forward that argument, because near-death experiences are getting more common. And that's partly because far more people are resuscitated through coronary resuscitation. There are now procedures in hospitals where near-death experiences are actually induced, in the sense not deliberately to make them near-death experiences, but to do certain kinds of heart operation. People are cooled down, their heart is switched off. And when you do that, patients have to be monitored very carefully. So they measure electrical and EEG activity in the brain. And there have now been quite a lot of studies like that. Some were done by a famous Dutch cardiologist, Dr. Pim van Lommel, who did a prospective study. He did these operations, and he decided in advance he'd ask people afterwards to see if they'd had near-death experiences. Many people didn't, but some did. And some of them were particularly vivid. And some of them involved them describing what happened in the operating theater while the person was actually having the operation, things they couldn't have known by any other means. And these happened when their brain was flatlined. There was no activity in the brain. So far from being having chaotic activity producing hallucinations, there was no detectable activity in their brains. And then the skeptic argument there was, well, it must have just been they made it up. When they regained consciousness, they confabulated this experience and projected it back in time. But the fact that some of them could remember things that had happened during the period when their brain was flatlining doesn't fit easily with that explanation. There are still people who want to cling to a materialist explanation, but if you look at all the facts together, I think that they point to something much more interesting. But my point this evening is not to try and argue with materialist philosophers about the interpretation of near-death experiences. I'm flagging this up to say they're under investigation. We've learned a lot we didn't know before about these, particularly from these operations under clinical conditions. But I want to deal with two or three other aspects of them. One is that it's possible to induce something very like a near-death experience through drugs. And the most powerful drug that creates sensations extremely similar to near-death experiences is the most powerful of all psychedelics, DMT, dimethyltryptamine. Many people who have taken dimethyltryptamine have had near-death type experiences. They've found themselves going out of their body into a realm of light and peace and blessing and then coming back. And the whole thing lasts about 5 minutes. And yet, for many people, it's one of the most profound experiences of their life. There are some people who say, well, it's not a real mystical experience if it's done by a drug. I'm not one of them. I think these experiences are what they are. And however it's induced, I'm not advocating everyone goes out and tries DMT either. What I'm saying is that there are experiences, drug-induced experiences, which can be very like near-death experiences. But that brings me to a bigger subject, really, which is rites of passage. In many cultures, there are rites of passage. When people move from one state of being to another, there's a social rite of passage where they undergo this transition. For example, getting married is a very familiar one, the rite of passage from being a single person to being a married person, where forming a new unit, the core of a family. And that's a rite of passage that's still widely celebrated in Britain today. Many cultures have rites of passage for young men and young women, for young women when they have their first period, when of course they bleed by definition. But for young men, rites of passage often involve periods of extreme difficulty, danger, and things that actually bring them quite close to death. In some cultures, they take poisons that bring them very close to dying. And I think that many rites of passage are indeed ways of inducing near-death experiences. The one that's most central to the Judeo-Christian tradition is, of course, drowning. You can induce a dying experience if you hold someone underwater long enough. Probably only takes a couple of minutes. And drowning people, as we know, their life flashes before them, they have classic near-death experiences. Now, what do you think was going on when John the Baptist was baptizing people in Jordan? They were lining up on the banks of the river. They go into the river. He holds them under the water. And many of them, after that, come back, they say they've died and they've been born again. They've seen the light. Their life has been completely transformed. They've undergone a complete transformation of their entire life. Everything that we know in the modern world happens with near-death experiences. So was it just symbolic that he held them underwater just symbolically to imitate death by drowning? Or did he hold them under just long enough to actually induce a near-death experience through drowning? It would only take a couple of minutes. It would be virtually free, very low-tech. And of course, that you couldn't do it now because that was pre-litigation. But it would fit all the facts perfectly. And I think it was a rebirth type experience for people. Interestingly, the Baptists are the people who brought this back here in England, in Europe, in the 16th century. The Anabaptists were people who wanted return to baptism. Instead of sprinkling water on infants, they thought baptism should be a true rite of passage, a true death and rebirth experience, and they reinstituted baptism by total immersion here in Britain. So the Anabaptists started this, and then they, of course, gave rise to the Baptists, and it's the Baptists in America, particularly the Southern Baptists, who are the ones who are most into death and rebirth and being born again. And most people treat them with utter contempt. I mean, the Southern Baptists are about as politically and intellectually incorrect as you can get, especially in America, where they're associated with the Tea Party, the religious right, etc. But they're, I think, the one group of people who've really kept alive the sense of death and rebirth and a very, very powerful rite of passage. Now, how many of them nowadays are held under long enough to induce a drowning-type experience? I don't know. That could only be found out by empirical research among Baptists. But I don't know many Southern Baptists myself. The only one I know in London is Jerry Hall, Mick Jagger's ex. And so I asked her what it was like for her. She said, well, she said it was a very, very powerful experience because in her church in Texas, they don't just do it with a sort of pit in the floor like in some Baptist churches here in England. It's in a kind of giant aquarium with glass walls so everyone can watch. And I said, was it just symbolic, or how long were you held under? She said, a lot longer than was comfortable, she said. So, I don't know what it was like in the 17th century here in England. You know, they may have lost a few, but this is a part of sort of history that's not, I've never seen a study on this. But I think it makes tremendous sense, you see, and I think it's also interesting that in the modern world, the near-death rite of passage is most commonly experienced by the young people I know, not through baptism or total immersion, but through psychedelics, through DMT, sometimes through ketamine taken in high doses or ayahuasca. Some people can have these near-death experiences, and I think this is probably one of the main areas in which, in modern Britain, people are actually undergoing these death and rebirth type epiphanies. Well, I want now to talk about something else to do with rituals and a scientific perspective on rituals that comes not, in this case, from totally accepted science, but from my own particular hypothesis of morphic resonance. Some of you know, and some of you probably don't know, that there's a hypothesis I put forward in the 1980s, which I'm still working on now, of morphic resonance, which is essentially the idea that the laws of nature are more like habits. The standard scientific assumption is the laws of nature were fixed at the moment of the Big Bang, and they've been the same ever since. Now, no one was there at the Big Bang to observe them or to measure them, so this is a pure assumption. And the reason it's there in science is because the founding fathers of modern science were Platonists or Pythagoreans who thought that the ultimate truth was mathematical. Basically, they thought God was a mathematician who made up mathematical laws of nature by thinking them. and that the job of science was to discover the mind of God by working out the mathematical formulae that were the mathematical laws of nature in God's mind. In the 18th century, the founders of the Enlightenment movement thought of Newton and the law of gravitation not as Newton just making up a provisional hypothesis that happened to work pretty well for all practical purposes, but of Newton actually understanding a divine truth, that science was a better way to truth, they thought, than revealed scripture, because science got directly to the heart of God's mind. So the founders of modern science in the 17th century, Copernicus, Galileo, Descartes, Newton, Boyle, and others, Kepler, were all Christians, and they all thought that God was a kind of mathematician. It was a kind of Neoplatonic or Platonic or Pythagorean interpretation of God. So this idea of the laws of nature as eternal mathematical truths, even though the laws we actually know may be provisional or we may not know them properly, but the idea that there is a kind of eternal realm of mathematical law underlying all nature is very deeply embedded in the thinking of scientists, particularly physicists. In the 19th century, most scientists tried to think that you could get rid of God by considering that the universe was eternal, made of eternal laws governing eternal matter, total amount of matter and energy always the same. But the Big Bang theory, which became orthodox in 1966, gives us a radically evolutionary view of the universe. And it raises the question, what about the laws of nature at the time of the Big Bang? Were they all there, like a kind of cosmic Napoleonic code, or have they evolved like everything else? And actually, the metaphor of law is a human metaphor. Only humans have laws. It's very anthropocentric. And human laws do, of course, evolve. But my argument is, and not just me, the philosopher C.S. Peirce, the theoretical physicist Lee Smolin, and a number of other people think that it makes much more sense to consider the regularities of nature as habits. That means there's a kind of memory in nature. And my hypothesis of morphic resonance is an attempt to explain how it works by suggesting that similar patterns of self-organizing activity influence subsequent similar patterns across space and time by this process I call morphic resonance, a kind of resonance from the past. Now, this leads to a completely new interpretation of memory. It suggests that the brain's more like a tuning system than a receiver. The memories are not stored inside the brain, we tune into them. That fits the facts of memory because all attempts to find memories in the brain have been unsuccessful so far. It also leads to a new interpretation of biological inheritance. A lot of inheritance is due to morphic resonance, not genes. And that fits the peculiar problem in biology at the moment of the so-called missing heritability problem, that 75% of inheritance has suddenly vanished. No one knows how it's working. Genes seem to account for far less than they were previously thought to. I discuss all this in my book, Science Set Free, the Science Delusion. I don't have time to go into the details, so I'm sorry to dazzle you with seemingly improbable ideas so fast, because I have to go over this very fast, because the point I want to get to is morphic resonance and ritual. Morphic resonance is a theory of collective memory. Each individual draws on a collective memory, a bit like Jung's collective unconscious, and contributes to it. Now, the key point about morphic resonance is similarity and repetition. Now, it turns out that in every culture, there are rituals, religious rituals or secular rituals, which are very, very widespread in all human cultures. Rituals are ways of reenacting a foundational story for that culture. So for the Jewish people, for example, the Passover ritual celebrated every year is a reenactment of the original Passover dinner in Egypt when the Jews killed a lamb and smeared the blood on the lintel of their house, and then the destructive curse on Egypt, which killed the firstborn of the people and their cattle, passed over the Jews and killed the Egyptians instead. And that was this final curse that enabled them to go free from Egypt. The freedom of the Jews was bought at the price of 10 terrible curses on the Egyptians. Blessings and curses go together very often. In this case, they did. So, since then, there's this reenactment of this Passover meal. And to be reenacted properly, the story has to be told of the Passover. It has to be a lamb. It's not the same with a nut cutlet. It's the right kind of food, the right kind of conditions. Has to be done in the right way. And by taking part in that Passover meal, Jewish people identify themselves as Jewish, become incorporated into the Jewish community, and believe that they're connecting with all those who've done it right back to the first Passover. Now, the same is true of the Christian Holy Communion, which was itself a Passover supper. And through reenacting that last meal of Jesus with his disciples, Christians who take part in communion feel they're reconnecting, they're affirming their identity as Christians, connecting with the central sacrificial act of the Christian faith, and connecting with other Christians who've done it in the past. The phrase communion of saints is the idea that through your part connected not only with those doing it at this particular time, but all those who've done it before, right back to the first time it's done. And a secular ritual, like the American Thanksgiving dinner, is very much the same. It's a reenactment of the first harvest Thanksgiving of the settlers in New England, their first year giving thanks for surviving in the New World. And the meal is centered around the turkey, an American bird which was unknown in Europe, which they learned about from the Native Americans. And so by taking part in the Thanksgiving dinner, they become identified as Americans, members of the American identity or national group, and they connect with all those who've done it right back to the first settlers. Now, every culture, secular and religious, has these rituals which reenact original events and incorporate people into the social group. Rituals, by their nature, are conservative. People feel that in order to work, they should be done the same way they've been done before. The same kind of incense, the same kind of words. Very often, liturgical languages are highly conservative. The Russian Orthodox services are in Old Slavic. Until recently, Roman Catholic services were in Latin. In the Coptic Church in Egypt, part of the liturgy is in the ancient Egyptian language, the only form in which it still survives. In India, the Brahminic rituals are in Sanskrit. So why do people feel they've got to have the ancient language, the proper forms, the right vestments, gestures, etc.? And why is there so much resistance to any kind of liturgical reform? In the Church of England, it takes the form of, for some people, strongly objecting to having the service in modern English rather than the Book of Common Prayer, Elizabethan English, which many people feel is more powerful, has a greater resonance. Well, mantras are a special case too, where sacred words are used to connect people with those who used them before, the whole lineage that's used them. What's going on here? From the kind of rationalist point of view, it's just mumbo jumbo and proves how stupid people are. But if you actually look at what's happening in rituals, the very fact people are deliberately doing things as similarly as they can to the way it's done before creates the ideal conditions for morphic resonance, and it means people will tune in to those who've done them right back to the first time they're done. There really will be a presence of the past, a connection across time, and the present living community will be linked with those who've gone before. It's an important fact about traditional cultures that they don't see the present participants in the culture as being the culture. They see the ancestors as being present and part of the cultural world that they inhabit, and the children, the descendants, even those yet unborn. We tend to have a very individualist culture where it's all about us. But this sense of the connection of the past is something that's actually being rediscovered in the family context through family constellation work, which is one of the most powerful forms of working with family patterns that I've ever come across. And one of the key things in that is there's a kind of memory carried unconsciously in the field of the family. So I think that these rituals, looking at rituals in this way makes a great deal more sense of them than it might otherwise seem. And finally, I want to deal with what's a contemporary issue in philosophy, namely panpsychism. Panpsychism is the idea that there's a kind of consciousness everywhere. Pan means everywhere, psychism means psyche or mind or soul. And this has become an astonishingly fast-growing movement in the modern world. There's always been panpsychism, of course. In the Middle Ages, the whole of Europe was basically panpsychist with a form of Christian animism based on the philosophy of Aristotle and St. Thomas Aquinas. The earth was alive, the planets and the stars were alive and intelligent, and all animals and plants had souls. The very word animal comes from the word anima for soul. That was what our ancestors believed. The scientific revolution is what said, no, it's the world's a machine, it's not an organism. Animals and plants don't have souls, they're just machines, and our bodies are just machines. The only thing left that's not a machine is the rational mind in humans and humans alone. That was the scientific revolution breaking with what went before. But what's interestingly happening now is that because of the problem of understanding consciousness in the materialist world, which says everything's matter, if you say everything's matter, there's no such thing as spirit, God, angels, or immaterial spirits, then how do you explain consciousness? And this is called in the philosophy of mind, as many of you know, the hard problem. The very existence of consciousness is a hard problem for materialism. Because if matter's unconscious, how do you get consciousness from unconscious matter? As materialists have been struggling to justify this, and some of them are still, like Daniel Dennett, strongly believe that given time, it will be explained. He admits there is no materialist explanation of consciousness now, but he says, you know, we're making rapid advances, give us 10, 20, 30, 50, 100 years, and we will explain it. So Karl Popper described that stance as promissory materialism, issuing promissory notes against future explanations. Undated promissory notes, usually. But there are other materialists who've taken a rather interesting turn. The first one to defect from standard materialism that I know of was Galen Strawson in recent years, a British materialist philosopher who wrote an article in the Journal of Consciousness Studies that caused a big stir. It said, it was called, Does Materialism Imply Panpsychism? And his answer was yes, because the only way you can explain consciousness emerging in brains is by supposing there's some more primitive form of consciousness in matter itself, even in electrons and in atoms. Of course, nothing like the kind of minds we know, but a primitive form of psyche. So he put forward a form of panpsychism. Now, whether that's really materialism or not is another question. He thinks it is, but it's certainly very unlike the familiar old-fashioned 19th century kind of materialism we've all grown up with. The next person to change over to panpsychism was the great American philosopher of mind, Thomas Nagel, whose book that came out a year and a half ago, some of you will have seen, is called Mind and Cosmos, Why the Materialist Neo-Darwinian Conception of Nature is Almost Certainly False. Now, Nagel, interestingly, is an atheist, and he's not arguing for religion, but he's arguing for panpsychism and also for teleology and evolution. He thinks there's a natural teleology at work in the evolutionary process. And so his view is it's a very interesting book because you see this intelligent, highly sophisticated man sort of trying to clamber out of the trap of materialism and the insoluble hard problem and come to something where he ends by saying we need a new kind of science which will look at things in a completely new way. Interestingly, the next person to go over to panpsychism was, in my experience, the most hardcore materialist of them all, Christoph Koch, who worked with Francis Crick on consciousness. 6 months ago, in an article in Scientific American, declared for panpsychism, saying he felt this was the only reasonable way that science could deal with consciousness. Now, of course, panpsychism in its modern revival is not very well worked out, but there's been plenty of panpsychist philosophers in the 17th century in reaction to Descartes. Leibniz was one of them, who said that nature's made up of self-organizing units, or monads, each of which has a body and a mind, and each of which reflects the whole universe from its own point of view. So the universe is made up of this whole set of mirrors of reflected from every point of view of conscious being, of the monads. Spinoza famously thought of the whole of nature as like the body of God and God as the mind of nature. But the most interesting of all panpsychist philosophers, to my mind, was Alfred North Whitehead in the 1920s, who came up with an idea of relation of psyche and matter, which is very original and interesting. Normally we think of mind and body as related as spatially, one being the inner and the other being the outer, the inner life, the outer world, and so on. But he thought the relation of mind and body was in time, not space. He realized, because he was a mathematician, he was one of the first philosophers to realize the radical implications of quantum theory. It took other philosophers decades to cotton on, but he got it straight away. If matter, like electrons, is made up of waves, since waves take time to wave, you can't have a wave at an instant, nor can you have a wave at a point in space. They're spread out in space and time. That's ultimately the reason for the uncertainty principle in quantum mechanics. You can't precisely locate anything that's a wave. And if they're waves spread out in time, then they must have a future and a past pole. And so he thought the mental pole was the future pole, and the physical pole was the past pole. And in electrons, in quantum theory, this is what we find. The Schrödinger equation describes all the possible things an electron could do. All the possible things it could do. They're not physical because they're possibilities. Possibilities are not physical. But as soon as it interacts with something or is measured in a laboratory, all those possibilities collapse down to one actual measured fact, which is now in the past. That's the physical fact. And it's sometimes called the collapse of the wave function. And now it's a physical fact. But when it's a possibility, it's not a physical fact. It's an equation, but it's describing possibilities which are not physical yet. They're virtual, as it were. Now, our own minds are like that. Our consciousness is concerned with the realm of possibility. Our minds are filled with possibilities, and there are ways in which we hold possibilities together and choose among them. And so, as an arena of possibility, consciousness is the future pole, and our bodies and our actions are the past pole, as it were, following Whitehead. For example, there was a time at which none of us had decided to come here this evening. It was one among many possibilities for where we'd be this evening. All of us chose to come here. And as soon as we come here, it's a measurable fact. We're here, we can be weighed, measured, etc. But our minds, when we were thinking about it, were dealing with a virtual future this evening at St. George's Church, Bloomsbury. That wasn't yet a reality, and it wasn't yet a physical fact. So this relation of future to past is what Whitehead thought is the relation of mind and body, or mind and decision or action. Now, the reason I go into all this background is that panpsychism gets a lot more interesting when you really take it seriously. It's very difficult for us to imagine what the life of an electron would be like, and most discussions of panpsychism center on electrons and atoms. But if this philosophy is true, then it should apply throughout all nature to all self-organizing systems. For me, it gets most interesting when we think of things that are much bigger than us rather than things that are smaller than us. And I'm thinking in particular of the sun. The sun is a self-organizing system. It has a body. And on this philosophy, it would also have a mind or a psyche. Now, what would the mind of the sun be like? If it's conscious and if it thinks, would be thinking about something, probably about its own body, the solar system, and possibly about its peer group, the other stars in the galaxy. We're not used to thinking about the mind of the sun. Everyone in this room has been brought up in a materialistic world where you know, as soon as anyone says the sun might be conscious, you know immediately this is a taboo subject. You're not meant to think that thought. You're meant to sneer the minute the idea comes up. And you're meant to sneer because everybody in the world except us modern smart Western people believes the sun is conscious. So the fact that everyone else thinks it's conscious and we're educated and we think it's not proves we're right and they're wrong. because it means we're superior to them. And the whole of this way of thinking is based on the fact we're superior to everybody in the past because we're smart and know about science. But actually, maybe we're not that smart, much smarter than other people. In traditional cultures everywhere, the sun is a god or a goddess or a living being. In India, it's Surya, the sun god. It was Apollo for the Greeks. In Japan, it's a goddess. It's not always a god. In many cultures, it's female, but it's conscious. And for children, it's treated as alive, at least. When children draw the sun, they give it a smiley face. Well, the fact that children think the sun's alive and conscious, and the fact that, at least implicitly, and the fact that other cultures do, as I say, is the main reason people have for saying it can't possibly be true. But perhaps it is. Perhaps the sun is conscious. There's nothing in science that tells us it's not. I can't prove the sun's conscious, but you can't prove it's not. And everything in science that measures things about the sun tells us true physical facts about the sun. But that doesn't prove it's unconscious. You can measure things about your body. That doesn't prove you're unconscious. It just proves that you've got physical, physiological changes going on, and you're conscious as well. I'm not suggesting the sun's mind could cause it to change its orbit, suddenly sort of swerve in a different direction. But the sun has a huge amount of electrical activity going on within it, which is now measured in much more detail than ever before. Resonant patterns, 11-year cycles of sunspots, and so on. And it sends out solar flares and coronal mass ejections. And where it sends them out, the direction it sends them out in, has a huge effect. If it pointed one at Europe and had a coronal mass ejection here, the whole of our power system would go out, and probably be out for months, if not years, because all the transformers would blow. We've created vast systems of antennae for solar flares in the form of power transmission lines, which would absorb this radiation and cause huge, total chaos. Everything would break down. The sun could do that tomorrow if it wanted. This is so important that NASA now has a space weather station. You get regular sun reports. They have a constant sun watch, precisely because it's so important for us. But if you think it's just a big hydrogen bomb and these things are all random, then that's one way of thinking about it. But it's not the only way. And it's not, although it's the way that most scientists think about it, it's not because they've proved the sun's not conscious. They haven't even discussed it. It's simply not on the agenda because of the prejudices of materialism. So let's say, for the purpose of argument, the sun is conscious. Then if the sun's conscious, what about the stars? They'd all be the same. They maybe all have minds. And in fact, our ancestors thought that. In the Middle Ages, it was thought that one of the many kinds of angel in the world were the intelligences of the stars. The heavenly bodies had minds, and those minds were their angelic intelligences that guided them and could influence events on Earth. The idea of angels in the Christian, Jewish, and Islamic tradition, or the idea of devas in the Hindu traditions, is the idea of many levels of being or mind or consciousness between the human and the divine. No one's ever had the idea that it's just our consciousness and God's consciousness and the rest of the universe is unconscious and there's nothing in between us and God. Some modern people think that, extreme Protestants perhaps, who have a very individualist spirituality. But that's not the way it's ever been conceived in any other traditional culture, including our own. And if the stars are conscious, what about the entire galaxy? What about a galactic mind? Could there be a vast mind of the galaxy ordering what happens in the stars? Well, and then what about the whole cosmos? Could that have a mind? If we have a panpsychist view, we're almost forced to the idea that there must be many levels of mind greater than ours, not just smaller than ours. And that means we're within those minds. We're all within the mind of the cosmos, if there is a mind of the cosmos. We're all within the mind or the consciousness of the sun, if we're within the solar system, and within the mind of the galaxy. So we're living in a world that's full of living beings and full of minds and levels of consciousness about which we in the modern world are hopelessly ill-informed. Most people have not even gone there to think about it for more than a couple of minutes. And if we see in traditional cultures people thought that way, then it's seen as, you know, beautiful, symbolic, but we've risen above it. We haven't. And I think that these are questions that are opening up at the moment. I'll end by saying that I think that the big challenge of this new era we're in now is for a dialogue between the realms of science, religion, and spirituality. Because science has revealed to us a universe far vaster than anyone ever conceived. Until the 1920s, it was not known that there were any galaxies beyond our own. We now know that there are billions of galaxies, that the universe appears to be about 14 billion years old. This vast vision of the universe has been opened by science. But for science, it's utterly meaningless. The universe is just made up of dead matter in motion, following impersonal mathematical laws. It has no meaning, significance, or consciousness. But for religious people, the universe does have meaning, significance, and consciousness. It's pervaded with the mind of God. It contains many forms of consciousness or intelligence beyond our own. But these religious views were formed in a tiny pre-modern cosmos where no one had any idea about the vastness of space, or indeed about the microscopic organization of matter or cells in living organisms or DNA or protein molecules. But from the point of view of science, it's unconscious, purposeless, and meaningless. No purpose in evolution. It's just blind processes in accordance with blind and unconscious and non-personal laws. So what's really needed, I think, is a way of bringing together the traditional insights of religion, but expanding them and developing them in this completely new context, which could give us a completely new understanding of the cosmos, and one which would not work against science, but which would work with science, and where this exploration could go on together. Today, it's barely begun, and we can just glimpse the beginning of something quite new that's happening. But I think this movement that's happening in our modern world at the moment is a fascinating one, a rediscovery of spirituality, a rediscovery, a reevaluation of our religious traditions, including practices like pilgrimage and festivals and communal celebration are so important for our personal and communal well-being, and a sort of breakdown of old-style materialism. In my book, Science Delusion, I show how the 10 dogmas of contemporary science are all falling apart for scientific reasons. They were formed in the 17th to the 19th century, but they've been superseded by science itself. So I'm not anti-science, I'm totally pro-science, but I think that when the sciences are liberated from this constrictive, dogmatic worldview that's at present encasing them, science will become much more exciting, much more adventurous, and open up these kinds of new perspectives and new possibilities for dialogue. Thank you.
Some time for questions. The building being what it is with the acoustic, it's even more important to keep questions short and sharp, and I'll try and relay them on the microphone so everyone can hear them. But if that doesn't provoke questions, I'm not quite sure what would. So there must be some questions, points, developments. Let's try the gentleman in the back here. If you can shout it out, then I'll try and repeat. So it's the question whether time changes, a bit like the laws being habits.
Well, the thing is that contemporary science is based on the assumption that time is like a uniform dimension. It's a simplifying assumption. You know, on Cartesian graph, you just have time as an axis. And the science is based on the assumption that the laws of nature are always the same, the constants of nature are constant, and that time flows uniformly. Now, these are all huge assumptions, and the entire Big Bang theory depends on them, because what happens is the universe is expanding now. So you say, okay, the laws have always been the same, it's expanding now, so let's crank it back by calculation until it gets smaller and smaller. And it finally gets so small it becomes what's called a singularity, all the equations go exponential and stuff. But this assumption that time and laws of nature are uniform is just that, an assumption. And without that assumption, it would be hard to do physics as it's currently practiced. There could be ways in which time has changed, and there are a lot of disputes within cosmology, because at present the idea of the universe is as old as it is, and that it's the further galaxies are receding from us, is based on the redshift, the displacement of light towards the red end of the spectrum. And the entire scale of the universe and the whole theory is based on that being true. But there are people who think that the redshift itself may be produced in a completely different way, not by them whizzing away from us by the Doppler effect, but by something else, including changes in the way that they relate to time. So there are alternative theories about time. I haven't followed the details of them enough to comment on any particular theory, but it's perfectly possible that things have worked differently in the past from the way they work now. But the only way we could find out about it is by looking for observations, but the trouble is they could always be interpreted in a different way, so it's not conclusive. It's of course the case that there are several kinds of time, as everybody knows. There's time as we subjectively experience it, which is often very different from clock time. And there's a time all living organisms have time within them, because they all grow up and get older. They don't grow down and get younger. There's a kind of direction to time in all living organisms, and indeed in the entire universe, because as it expands, the arrow of time in the universe is the expansion of the universe. It's also greatly argued within quantum physics as to whether retrocausation is possible, whether causation can work backwards in time. Richard Feynman thought it could, and he was a Nobel Prize winning physicist. So there are many questions here, and I think that we're not going to see the end of this debate anytime soon.
Yeah, gentlemen here. So asking about what is real and the various ideas perhaps that come out of quantum physics, that various kinds of illusion might actually be what we call real.
Well, there's a long philosophical tradition, of course, about seeing the world as something primarily mental. You know, in Hinduism, there are stories about the god Vishnu. God Vishnu lies down to dream. And he dreams asleep for an awfully long time, dreaming for a long time. And this universe that we're in is Vishnu's dream. So that is one sort of way of thinking of the whole universe as mental. Bishop Berkeley in the 18th century, one of our great philosophers, you know, thought that the whole world could just as well be seen as being made of ideas than matter. And in the 19th century, there were many philosophers, idealists, who thought that consciousness was the only reality. In the 19th century, with Cartesian dualism, which said there's two different things, consciousness, which is not in space and time, and matter, which is, some people tried to get rid of this dualism by saying it's all consciousness, that's idealism. Some tried to get rid of it by saying it's all matter, that's materialism, which came about by denying the consciousness aspect of Cartesian dualism. So in terms of whether it's an illusion or not, this is a recurrent idea, and it comes up in a scientific context. Sometimes people say, well, in quantum theory you can only know about things that have been observed by an observer, therefore it's all in the mind. But actually that's a very narrow way of thinking about it. The philosopher Schopenhauer pointed out in the early 19th century, all observations require an observer. All knowledge requires a knower. And so that's a sort of basic point. But whether or not we can regard consciousness as an illusion, as some materialist philosophers do, they say that consciousness itself is an illusion. The trouble is that since illusion is a mode of consciousness, that doesn't really get rid of consciousness. It makes it even more mysterious. So I certainly think there are illusions, but I don't take the view the whole world is an illusion. I think the world is interpreted through our minds, and that we interpret it often in ways that aren't appropriate or might be false. But you know, it's more like our interaction with the world that gives rise to our knowledge and understanding of it. And, you know, if I'm interacting with somebody in a conversation, then how I am and how I behave affects the whole conversation. If I'm hostile and suspicious and paranoid, they're likely to become rather edgy. And if I'm friendly and open, they're likely to be more friendly and open. And the quality of the interaction depends partly on me, but it's not all in my mind. And I think that that's true of nature. I think science is, and indeed all of us, are interacting with the natural world. The interaction depends very much on the way our minds, our motives and our attitudes, but I don't think it's all illusion.
Yep, thank you, the front end. So this is about artificial intelligence and how the computer metaphor for mind affects the search for artificial intelligence.
Yes. Well, I think, I think that to some degree the ultimate materialist fantasy was to prove that we're nothing but machines by making machines that are like us. And the machine thing, the problem with the machine metaphor is that machines are man-made. The only place they occur in the universe, as far as we know, is in modern human societies. They're made by us. And they're then taken as a metaphor for us ourselves, and indeed for the whole of nature. So the whole of mechanistic and materialist science since the 17th century has used the metaphor of the machine as the primary paradigm for nature and for ourselves. And of course, the computer metaphor, the brain's a computer, is one way of doing this. And the dream of some people is that if we can prove that computers can become conscious and intelligent, then we'll have finally proved we're nothing but machines. That's, for some people, the underlying motive behind all this. However, it's been severely disappointing, the artificial intelligence thing. I remember 20 years ago, we were told fifth-generation computers would do all sorts of things. They don't do anything like that. Computers do wonderful things, and they can play chess and so forth. But many of those fantasies have never come true. And the kind of singularity fantasies of people like Ray Kurzweil, I think, are nothing but fantasies. And the reason I think that computers will not become conscious is because if you look at the way that living organisms or self-organizing systems work, they all work on the basis of a very high level of indeterminacy. Quantum processes are indeterminate. Brain activity is indeterminate. It's probabilistic, in the words, the scientific words. You can only predict things in terms of probability. The weather's indeterminate. Chaotic dynamics is now what's used to model the weather and breaking waves and things. Almost all of nature is indeterminate and probabilistic, including us. The only things in nature that are not, that are rigidly deterministic, follow deterministic laws, are man-made machines. And we make them to be deterministic. When you press an A key on the computer, you want it to give you an A every time, not a B sometimes, or a Z. So we've created this kind of artificial realm of determinism in our machinery, which is unlike everything else in nature, including our own brains. and I don't think that I think the way that minds work on brains is through patterning indeterminism. I think the way that morphic resonance and morphic fields work on systems to give them their memory and their form is through patterning otherwise indeterminate events. And now that can't happen in a computer because it's rigidly determinate. And even when people introduce pseudo-random algorithms into computers to give randomness, it's done according to a program. It's not real randomness. I think it's possible that something mind-like could emerge in a machine if that machine were an analog computer, not a digital one and if it had a high degree of quantum randomness in it. And quantum computing is actually rather like that. There is now the leading edge of computing today is quantum computing, where randomness is inherent in quantum systems and where some of them work on basically analog principles, global, overall, holistic principles, rather than breaking everything down into granular bits of information. Digital computers break everything down into bits, yes, no, bits. So everything's granulated, pixelated into tiny bits. But analog computers work by global patterns of activity. Those, I think, could conceivably give rise to a completely new kind of artificial intelligence, and quantum computing could lead us there, but I don't think digital computing will ever do that.
So I know you're friends with Terence McKenna. What do you think of his theory that psychedelics played a role in the evolution of human consciousness? And that I suppose that could be one way you could interpret the story of the fall in Genesis.
This is a question about the role of psychedelics in the evolution of human consciousness, particularly with the theory of Terence McKenna, and then looking at the fall in Genesis as an instance of this, perhaps.
Well, Terence McKenna was very interested in psychedelic shamanism, and he took part in what he sometimes called hands-on pharmacology. He was more interested in the traditional uses of psychedelics, ayahuasca, ibogaine, cannabis, and other the magic mushrooms. And his idea was, it's an idea that's being propagated today quite forcibly by Graham Hancock, is that these have such a powerful effect on people who take them today. They must have had an equally powerful effect when people took them in the past, if not more powerful, because people then weren't used to seeing full color, high-definition TV, etc. The imagery they got would have been very, very more striking in the absence of our technology. And we know that some of these plants have been used for a long time, and we know that some ancient mystery cults, like the Eleusinian missionary mysteries in Greece, involved psychedelics. So his idea is that at some key stage in human evolution, people discovered psychedelics, discovered these realms of experience, which connected them not just with realms of their own minds, but connected them with other minds, because he felt that under the influence of ayahuasca in particular, there could be connection with spirits or other kinds of intelligence or mind, which could have passed information to humans. It's hard to deny that psychedelics are present in many cultures, but they're not present in all cultures. And Terence did tend to play down the realm of religion, religious experience, spontaneous mystical experience, out-of-the-body experiences, the effects of fasting and other ways of inducing altered states of consciousness. He was rather single-minded in his pursuit of the psychedelic hypothesis. And so I think it's part of the answer, but I don't think it's the whole one. And his theory of the fall is particularly implausible in my view. The basic idea is that in these early partnership societies, people were taking mushrooms in a way that was particularly mind-altering and led to this harmonious, balanced society where they didn't have war and they lived in harmony with each other and so on. Then there was climate change caused by the end of the Ice Age. The climate in some parts of the world got drier, and mushrooms stopped growing in such profusion. And so they were suddenly deprived of mushrooms, which gave this paradise-like society. And instead, they had to revert to much lower-level drugs, like alcohol. And this was the fall, which changed the whole of human society, and that paradise could be restored if everyone started taking mushrooms again. That's an oversimplification of his theory, but it does show... I mean, he did have this rather idealized view. I think that's highly implausible. But I think it's very plausible that psychedelics have played a part, an otherwise often neglected part, in human evolution. And are one today, as in the past. They're one of the ways, perhaps more important today for many people in a materialistic post-Christian culture that many people live in. Psychedelics are a way, an acceptable way of getting into the spiritual realm, because they are, after all, molecules, and molecules are very acceptable. They fit within the materialist model, even though they may open up vistas that are quite non-molecular.
We've got time for one more, I think. We just have to get one more. You're using the word consciousness. I would like to know what you mean by consciousness.
So, could you say more on what you mean by consciousness?
More about what I mean by consciousness. Well, I think all of us know what consciousness is to some extent. It's, you know, how do you define red? You know, you can say certain things, but what I mean by consciousness is, first of all, awareness. I'm not talking about self-consciousness particularly, I'm talking about awareness. And how I think consciousness works and how I think of it is in terms of possible actions. I think our consciousness is primarily to do with possible actions. Even visual perception is to do with possible actions. Everything I see, I can potentially name, and that's a possible action. At least if I recognize it, if it's a form that I can recognize, I can potentially name it. And so my perceptual world is different from that of animals in that it's influenced by language. But even for animals, I think that non-human animals, I think that the perceptual world would and perceptual awareness would depend to a large degree on possible actions. You know, most animals don't see everything uniformly. We all, like all other animals, have highly selective attention. If we're feeling hungry, we notice food and smell bread and that kind of thing. If we're sexually aroused, then our mind goes to other things. And if you're looking for something, you tend to see what you're looking for. Because I'm interested in plants, when I walk around Hampstead Heath, I notice lots of plants. I often go for walks with people, and it's clear that they don't notice them at all. They don't know what they are. Their mind's on something else, probably equally valid, but it's just all attention selective. So I think we have to see attention and consciousness as to do with potential actions. I think it inhabits a realm of possibility, which is a virtual realm, and it's largely concerned with choosing among future actions, or choosing among actions, or where we're going to put our attention. So that's how I understand it. Now, defining it, as I say, I've never found it a very fruitful exercise. Whenever I see people defining consciousness, it just gets into endless verbal disputes that get us nowhere. And as I say, you can't define an experience, because we can't even, at all qualities, famously in the philosophy of mind, qualia, any quality, the sensation of red, is non-definable, because to put it into words only makes sense if you already know what red is. You can't, someone who's colorblind, you can't explain redness to them. So I think consciousness as a whole, we all know the difference between being asleep and awake, and we all know that our consciousness can go through very different stages. We all know that we also have dreams, which are a different kind of consciousness. And I think it's better to start from what we all know than verbal definitions. That's my own approach.
I think we're going to have to call it a close there for the formal bit, but there are many ways of pursuing this. One is that Rupert has bought some books for sale, and he'll be sitting at the desk there to sign the books, but also to talk further. Another way, if you'll excuse a joint plug, is that Rupert and myself, I'm Mark Vernon, we've done some podcasts pursuing some of these questions as well. You can get them from Rupert's website or from iTunes. Even more generally, you might want to pursue similar questions in the future by making sure you're on the list for the London Philosophy Club Wisdom. If this is your first visit here, I guess you can find that online quite easily. So let me now just finish by thanking Rupert very much indeed for an enormously wide-ranging, stimulating and provocative discussion.